All right, so you should see that this meeting is being live streamed. So welcome to episode 45 of our Tuesday Tech Talks. I can't believe it. We're going to hit 50 episodes 1st of March. All right, it's be a lot of fun. Today, we're very, very pleased to have Mr. the one, the only Jared Covili, or some people say, you know, Clint Stevens North, or, you know, I'm Jared Covili South, whatever. However you want to look at it. I'm happy to be, you know, even in the same, you know, Zoom room as this guy. So glad to have him here today. He's been running our Utah Ed Chat for many years, as long as I've known about it. And I will turn the time over to Jared.
Well, hello, everybody. It's good to be with you. As Clint kind of mentioned, I've been involved in Utah Ed Chat for a long time. By way of introduction, my name is Jared Covili. I'm in the Jordan School District right now as part of the Digital Teaching and Learning Department. I've been here for about a year. Prior to that, I've met a lot of you over the years. I'm working for the Utah Education Network and spent a lot of time coming down into your region of the state and spending time working with you guys on a lot of fun projects. So fun to be with you again today, even if it's in a different arena where now I have to wear a tie, but that's okay. A lot of people like to make fun of me about that. So I've got some slides that I want to talk about with you just a little bit. Today I'm going to talk a little bit about the changing nature of professional learning for people. And I'm going to show you, just kind of as we get started here, I need to do one quick thing. I got to stop my share because I forgot to turn on my volume when I share a video clip. Okay, this time I'll do it right. Oh, you're kidding me. It makes me want to reinstall Zoom.
Oh.
Of course.
Must have been an update. Yeah, can you shoot me the link in chat and I can share it?
I think it'll work. I put in my share settings, my password. Let's see if it works.
Okay.
If it doesn't, I'll just shoot you the link to it, but no big deal. So I want to kind of get started with this kind of thinking about professional development or professional learning situations and sessions that we've maybe been in. And as we kind of kick it off here, I'm going to show you a little clip from a training that happened outside of Chicago in a school district there.
The vocabulary matrix. What's the strategy we're using today?
While this was being, while this training so was being given, somebody pulled out their phone and started to record. A choral response.
So repeat after me. We will
use
accurately.
So we don't need to continue watching this. But as we're kind of listening to this, I can see some of you kind of cringing here as you're seeing this clip, right? So as we kind of move forward just a little bit, maybe in the chat, can you just share with us what are some of the challenges with traditional professional development like this where there's an expert up at the front of the room and everybody has to learn the exact same thing in the exact same way. What do you see as some of the challenges with those kind of traditional methods of professional learning or professional development? So Clint's asking, hey, I don't even know how I get stuff graded. I mean, if I'm trying to do too many things here, we've got JT Poole saying, yeah, there's a ton of different levels of prior knowledge. Some people get bored, some are overwhelmed. There's a lot of disengagement with this kind of a learning because we're trying to do a one size fits all or fits most when we do learning like this, right? And we know there's a lot of different ways that people learn nowadays. Well, let's go on and keep looking at this. So a few years ago, I uncovered something that just really blew my mind. It was professional learning using Twitter. And at the time, I have to tell you, I was kind of, I wasn't necessarily new to Twitter. I joined Twitter in 2007. So, I mean, Twitter was pretty new in 2007. But I had pretty much only used it for, like, I'd go to a conference and I would take notes with it. So I'd be in a session and I'd tweet out something that the person who was doing the presentation had said. And it really wasn't that meaningful to me because I was really just using it as a glorified note taker tool for me. But at some point I started to clue into something about Twitter, is that Twitter is less sometimes about me just regurgitating stuff that I've heard, but it's way more about me connecting with the people in that are reading what I'm writing, or the people that I want to read what they're writing. And so Twitter, just in case you're not totally familiar with it, it's an online social media tool. A lot of us have heard of it, right? But maybe you're not currently familiar that now you can write up to 280 characters. It used to be that you had half that size, so you had to be very concise in what you wrote. But it's a great way that you can include not only text, but you can include images, you can include links to resources. And personally, I kind of tell people that I try and keep my social networks separate. So like Twitter is a very professional tool that I use. So you will rarely see me talking about like what I'm doing on my vacation on Twitter, or you'll rarely see me talk about what I am eating for dinner on Twitter. I choose to use other social media platforms for those kinds of things, but this particular one, it's kind of fallen into my professional one. So that's where I share. And I think I follow at least two of Clint's five Twitter accounts, but that's another story altogether. So what are some of the complaints against Twitter? And I'm sure some of you have heard some of these. Like, I don't care what people are eating and they're taking photos of their lunch. I tried to use Twitter, but it's too fast. Like, this goes so fast and I can't keep up with what's going on. So I couldn't follow it. Some people just say, I don't like social media. I'm a little bit frustrated by just the way that people communicate. Like, right now, a lot of us would say that there's a lot of trolling going on, or just real negativity on Twitter with some people. And then they say, maybe I only use social media in my personal life. So I'm a Facebooker, or I'm an Instagrammer, and that's how I connect with my family and friends and all those kinds of things. I heard a quote years ago, and I really like it, actually. They said that Facebook is a tool that they use in their life to connect with the people that they've known over the course of their life. But Twitter is a tool to connect with the people they'd like to get to know, and people that they would like to have as part of their network. And I think that's kind of a weird, kind of a fun twist on it, right? Like, so much of my life, the people that I connect with in my life that are friends from before, like high school or family or different things, I really do use those tools like Instagram and social media to connect with them. But because I use Twitter as my professional account, man, they're really kind of a way that I'm outreaching to people that I'm interested in or people that I'd like to know more about. You can read in the chat that Kara and Clint are both kind of saying how they like that. That's part of their view of it. Kara says, I know a ton of people on Twitter that I'd like to get to know in real life. So let's keep going with our little talk here about it. So the first thing that I would say that really changed my view of Twitter is this concept of building a professional learning network, abbreviated as a PLN. And so a lot of us have PLCs at school, or we have different groups that we're part of. But specifically, I would say a social media PLN are people that you connect with online. And they're people that you connect with either using Twitter or a variety of social media tools. But I'd just love, if you wouldn't mind sharing in the chat with us, how do you define a PLN for yourself? Like, when you're trying to find information online, or you're trying to find out information in your world, who do you connect with? Who are some of the go-to sources for you? And how do you see that as being a role for learning in your world? So I'll give you a second to type that in the chat. Yeah, so JT Poles is saying, there's a lot of people that are part of my PLN, whether it's people from the region like Clint and Chris, or keynotes from USET like Matt Miller, or people who use some of the tools that I like, Google, whatever those might be. Clint sharing that he tends to rely on people from, like, people that he does know in his real life, but to connect with them in social media spaces as well, like maybe groups that he's part of. Like technology trainers or different folks. Chris is talking about how she really likes it when she can connect with the people that she's met online in real life. Like, it's kind of fun when you've been chatting with somebody in a social network, but now you're connecting with them at a conference or at an event where you can see them. Kira says, PLNs are a wider network of people, professionals and experts that I can ask questions from, get feedback from. And David says, there's a lot of like people that are tech people that I like to connect with because we share a similar interest. So there's a lot of different reasons for this. I will say that one of the values of a social network, like using some of these tools like Twitter, is a lot of times your sphere of influence in the past was connected with your proximity to someone, right? Like if I'm in Cedar City, I'm really close to Clint and Chris. I probably can connect with them very easily and get information from them. But if I'm in Garfield, it may be really hard for me to connect with people in kind of the same way. I may be the only person in my building that's really interested in this stuff. So now the social media tools have really broadened the room. I mean, it really expanded our area of influence to where we can connect with people all over the state, all over the country, and all over the world based on what our interests are and what we're interested in learning about. So as you start thinking about tweeting, just a couple things that I want to point out to you. There's a few things that, you know, we start getting into this concept of a hashtag. So it's the pound sign. So hashtags allow you to share a theme or a concept as part of your message. So let's use an example. If I'm really into, I'm a third grade teacher and I'm really into math. Maybe one of the things that I teach and that I want to share ideas with is about fractions. So after I ask a question, I may put third fractions after the little pound sign. And that what that does is it immediately filters that comment to being part of anyone who's looking at third grade fractions. That's something they're interested in. So it basically takes the web and the Twitter from being this really broad thing where everything's going on. And by putting a hashtag, we can narrow it down to a specific topic or really almost a specific group of people that might be interested in something. So a couple other things to keep in mind. If you use a lot of hashtags, number one, it takes up some of your 280 characters. And number two, you probably are reaching out to more groups than may be interested in every one of your comments. So sometimes you need to be a little bit judicious in who you want to share your comment with, because there's probably a primary group that you're looking to reach out to and maybe a secondary group. But you probably don't want to put too many more than that into a tweet. Another thing that you'll see is there's this concept of the at sign. And I'm kind of going to fast forward one slide here, because what we're really talking about is the difference between maybe like a handle and a hashtag. When you put the at sign in front of a word, you're actually referencing someone's account. So you're trying to reach a specific person. So like on Twitter, my Twitter account is at, and then my last name. So it's at Covili. So if you put the at sign and then my last name, any comment that you make in Twitter will actually get sent to me. It'll actually come as like you're having a conversation with me. You want to reach out to me. And those can be not only people, but it can be, like you see here, I work in Jordan District. So there's our Twitter handle for the district. It's at Jordan District. Or it could be an organization like the at First Lego League. So I could reference a specific organization, a person, maybe it's a business. But you, if you know what their handle is, that's how you can reach out directly to them. If you're interested in a topic is the pound sign. So that's called a hashtag. And so things like right now, this is a really good example. UTED stands for Utah Education. You'll see during these couple of months when the legislative session is going on that a lot of comments related to the legislation surrounding education will have that pound sign UTED on it. And so people who are trying to follow those bills, it's very easy for them to find specific content related to a bill or something like that. And then I just listed a few others. Like if you're super interested in educational technology, if you put do a search in Twitter for #EdTech, it's only going to have comments about ed tech. It's not going to be about, you know, what people are eating for lunch or different things like that. A couple of years ago, Jimmy Fallon made a pretty funny little video about this. I'm just going to show you a minute of it so you can kind of see. Sometimes we get a little overload on hashtags.
Hey, Justin, what's up?
Not much, Jimmy. Hashtag chilling. What's up with you?
Just been busy working. Hashtag rise and grind. Hashtag is it Friday yet?
Hey, check it out. I brought you some cookies. Hashtag homemade. Hashtag oatmeal raisin. Hashtag show me the cookie.
Sweet. Hashtag don't mind if I don't. Pretty good. Hashtag getting my cookie on. Hashtag I'm the real cookie monster. Hashtag no, 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 no.
Delicious, right? Yeah. Hashtag I did it all for the cookie. Hashtag LOL,
Hashtag classic. By the way, did you catch last week's episode of Duck Dynasty? Hashtag quack, quack.
Nah, lately I've mostly been watching Netflix. Hashtag orange is the new black.
Oh, nice. I've been watching a lot of Barney the Dinosaur. Hashtag purple is the new black. Hashtag I love you, you love me, we're a happy family. Hashtag I'm 38. Hashtag dinosaurs. Hashtag how do they go extinct? Hashtag meteor. Hashtag ice age. Hashtag speaking of ice age, I just watched Ice Age on demand the other day. Hashtag funny. Hashtag Ray Romano. Hashtag Deborah. Deborah. Hey, by the way, Halloween's only like a month away.
I know.
I mean, do you know where you're gonna be at? Hashtag life decisions, hashtag sexy ghost.
I think I'm gonna go as a ninja turtle. Hashtag gotta be Raphael. Hashtag Leonardo sucks. Hashtag the turtle, not the Italian Renaissance painter. Hashtag Mona Lisa. Hashtag is she smiling? Hashtag speaking of smiling, I just saw my dentist. Hashtag bling. Hashtag dental care. Hashtag cavity free. Hashtag that's how we do. Hashtag we go hard. Hashtag and we can't stop.
Hashtag we won't stop.
Hashtag we run this.
Hashtag true players for life.
Hashtag is it worth it or let me work? Get.
Hashtag put my thing down, flip it, then reverse it.
Hashtag, hashtag is your permanent again yet? Hashtag is your permanent again yet?
Hey guys.
Yeah, Quest?
What's up?
Hashtag shut the f up.
So if you hadn't seen that, that's a pretty funny thing. It's pretty dated though, right? Like obviously we've got the hashtag Duck Dynasty.
Yeah, I didn't feel like it was that long ago. I remember seeing that when it was on, but that's funny.
Yeah. So as we talk about hashtags versus handles, then let me just give you an example. So here are some groups or some individuals that you might want to follow, right? So for example, we're going to talk about Utah Ed Chat in just a second, but you can actually follow a Twitter account that keeps you up to date on it. Most of us in the room here are part of the USET organization. So that's the statewide technology organization. If you aren't following USET, you can follow at USET. This is one that we just created in Jordan School District for our digital teaching and learning group. So that's another one where you can follow. And Karen and I are sharing different things about how to use technology in your class. But you can also follow a lot of people. So excuse me, this is a little bit like, where's Waldo? Can you see the tech specialist in front of you on my slide today? So you can see some of our friends that are from all over parts of the state, but Clint mentioned he's got five different accounts, but I'm assuming his primary one that he uses is at SEDC Clint. And you can see that if you wanted to follow him, that's a good way to follow him.
The rest of them are secret.
And Chris has got Barrel Girl as her hashtag there. So I've been dying to find out though, Chris. Can you share this? Tell us about the name Barrel Girl.
It's Burl Girl, and I actually made that 20 years ago when I lived in Burl.
I assumed it was a small town that I've never been in. But.
Yep, that's where I lived. I was just telling Clint the other day, you know, I was thinking about changing that because it doesn't really make sense. And I did it, you know, when I first started Twitter, and I didn't even really think about it. And I never knew I'd be here tweeting like this 20 years ago. So think about it when you make your Twitter account.
Now, I will say at any point you can change it and you don't lose all your followers and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, it is one of those things that you kind of let people know when you're doing it. But I see in the chat that Clint's also Don Clintone. So I've seen that one pop up before. But if you wanted to follow Kira, it's Kay Bettis. A couple other people that maybe you don't know as well. Tabitha Pacheco, if you don't know who she is, She runs a group called the Utah Teacher Fellows. I'll let Kara mention something about her since she knows more about it than me.
Yes, so the Utah Teacher Fellows are a group of Utah teachers that are learning leadership skills. And one of the things that we do as part of the fellows is advocate and share teacher stories. And one way that we do that is through Twitter. So the Utah Teacher Fellows, they take a week each month to facilitate the Utah Ed Chat. And then they also are encouraged to publish their stories in op-eds or on podcasts or in blogs around just to share their teacher stories and to advocate for the profession. So it's a really great program. I myself was a fellow just this last cohort, and I actually work with the fellowship as one of the network leaders now. So they're a great follow. Tabitha Pacheco does a lot of like teacher advocacy and like opportunities for teachers. So she's a great follow, and she's also a good one to kind of keep tabs on in case you're interested in joining the fellowship. She'll let you know when that opportunity arises again.
Yeah, so I'm just sharing with you some great people that you can follow, but there's a ton of great people in your area. How do you get started kind of following people? So let's use my account as maybe a little example. A lot of people will say, oh, I'm a really big fan of what Clint and Chris are doing down in SCDC, so I want to follow them, but I don't really know who else to follow. So one thing that I always suggest to folks as you're kind of getting started with this is once I follow Clint, I click on this little option just below his name where it tells me who he's following. So then it gives me a list of some of the different groups or individuals that Clint is following. And I find that's a really convenient way for me to add a bunch of those folks to my list. Because, you know, like I say, usually when you trust somebody as a good resource, I probably trust them to be a good judge of who else is a good resource too. So I usually go through their list and kind of follow. Now, I will say one thing about this is I pretty much, as a rule of thumb, I'm trying to follow people that are in education. And so I always recommend to people that when you create your Twitter account, if you haven't made one before, to include that you're a teacher. Like that's a really big part of it, because that's a big filter for me as far as whether or not I'll follow somebody. Because if they don't say anything about teaching, I may follow them, but if they say they're a teacher, it's really likely that I'll follow them, because I want to have this be my professional network. So I spend a lot of time with that. So we've kind of talked a little bit about Twitter. Now let's talk about using it as a Twitter chat. And Chris is kind of sharing a little comment there that Ed Chats are a great place to find good people to follow. So we've just mentioned now, if we use Twitter and we start thinking about sharing ideas about education, where can we connect with a bunch of other educators? And Twitter chats are a great place to do this, because it's usually at a set time where several of us will all be participating in a conversation about a specific topic related to education. And so this is a great place to connect with other people. I find that it's a good way for you to build your learning network, because if people are kind of jumping in to a chat like this, they're people that I want to associate with. And so I find that that's a great place. When people ask me, how do you describe Utah Ed Chat? I kind of describe it as the conversation in the faculty room you hope you are part of. You know how there's that conversation in the faculty room where we're all kind of burned out and that one teacher comes in and just starts complaining about Billy again and again and again? And sooner than later, you find yourself maybe not going to the faculty room for lunch sometimes, because it just gets overwhelming to have that same conversation over and over again. But then other days, you have this great conversation where you're talking about learning, and you're engaged with each other, and you're learning from each other. And you're like, man, couldn't it be like this every day? This is the kind of conversation I want to be part of. And that's what I've found about these Twitter chats, is a lot of times it's those people that are involved that are trying to make a difference and trying to share ideas. Oh, Kara says she's actually used Utah as Ed Chat as a way to spark conversation during lunch. So just share more about that, Kara. What'd you do?
Yeah, so particularly when because I'm terrible at conflict, but particularly when like the conversation was getting really negative and I was like, well, this is not helping anybody, right? It's just making everyone angrier. So I try to do it subtly, but sometimes it wasn't. I'd be like, so guys, this is the topic of Utah Ed Chat. What do you think? And most of my teachers weren't ones that would go to Twitter necessarily, but it was a good way to bring up a conversation and say, hey, we had a discussion about media literacy this week, or we had a discussion about classroom management techniques. Like, what are your favorite resources? And then it was just a way to kind of spark a better conversation than that negative spiral. And it was something too that I could be like, oh, I know a teacher at Harriman, or I know a teacher down in St. George who's doing something really cool. Like, and it was the way to kind of help them branch out and like see that there are other educators doing some cool stuff too.
Yeah. Now, Clint, I'm pausing this for a second. I don't know how much time you want me to take. 5 minutes? Okay. I just saw it. Let's jump in and get to the nitty gritty of this. So let's talk about Utah Ed Chat. So Utah Ed Chat really began in 2013 as a way for Utah educators to connect with each other. I like to say that I reintroduced it in 2014. I didn't know about it when it first got started. I was at a conference in Wyoming and they were talking about this chat that they were doing. And all of a sudden I was like, do we have one of those in Utah? Like Wyoming's got this group of educators that are all getting together to talk. And I remember saying, man, we should be doing that in Utah, because if Wyoming can do it, anybody can do it. I'm teasing, of course, but so we said, yeah, let's do one. So we started this in 2014. And since then, we've done one pretty much every week during the school year outside of, you know, Christmas break and some of those kinds of times. But we've been doing this for the last almost 8 years. And it runs every Wednesday night from 9 p.m. until 10 p.m. But we've had almost 300 chats during that time. And over 100 different people have participated as moderators, meaning they led the discussion. So if you want to find out more about what the chat looks like coming up, you can go to You can go to utahedchat.org, or you can go, I think in the chat itself, Clint shared a link that will take you. That page has a little bit of instruction as well as the upcoming schedule of what's happening in the next few weeks. We try and make sure you know what's coming up. So if it's something you're interested in, you can jump in. So the chat kind of works like this. When you go to Twitter at 9 o'clock on a Wednesday night, you'd put in the hashtag UTED chat. And all of a sudden, all that other stuff goes away. And you'll see that whoever's moderating it will put in a question with the Q1 little abbreviation before it. That just means that this is the first question of the chat. When you respond, it helps if you put A1, meaning this is my answer to question one. And then it kind of keeps everybody together so that you're answering questions back and forth with the group. You do want to make sure you use the hashtag UTAD chat. Otherwise, the group doesn't see your comment, right? So that's pretty important as part of your questions or replies, that you just use that Utah Ed Chat hashtag. And then the best part of this is you can start having conversations with people. I found that there are times when it's not necessarily the question from the moderator that gets me talking to others, but it's people's responses. And I find that that's when I really start to have these little side conversations with people that are really meaningful to me. Maybe Kira or Chris, you want to share your thoughts about that?
Like I said earlier, I am a Utah Chat fan, and this was the way that I found my PLN growing the fastest, was that I would see people who would participate in the Ed Chats. I liked what they were saying. I liked what they were sharing. And it was a way to follow them and kind of include them in that wider network. And then when I would run into them at conferences, or when I would see them at different schools, it was kind of like we already had, I was like, oh, hey, there's my friend. There's my Twitter friend. It was just a really good way to find more resources, having like more feedback on ideas that I was trying out, more than just was in my school or what was nearby.
How about you, Chris? Any thoughts
from you? I think Kara said it just great. You know, you get that, you know, I've said in the chat, you get ideas out of your comfort zone, things that I would have never thought about doing it that way, or links to other things. And so you just get a different perspective on things, something that I would have never thought of. and different ideas. So yeah, I think I love the conversations and the side bits. I know there's, I think his name is Rourke. There's another teacher on there that's been in a couple of times, and he's just had some great ideas of what he's done in his class. And it's just kind of inspiring too, to see the great things that teachers are doing. So yeah, I love the side conversations as well.
So we're out of time. I'm just going to share one last resource with you all about using the chat. So
Jared, you might be good to like just jump onto Twitter and just kind of show how to search, how to just, you know, instead of talking about it, just actually show how to,
happy how to find to those go tweets. Out and do that real quick.
Yeah.
And so well, you can go a little long. I've got
a link in the chat if you need to sign the role. If you need to go sign the role, and we'll see later. If not, we're good to stick around as long as Jared's got and answer questions, whatever.
So go ahead, I've Chris. Got a burning question that gets me every time we do an Ed chat. So when you, speaking of the responses, is it better to reply or use the little bubble, the message bubble, or to reply with a quote? What's the difference?
So let's look at this just for a second and kind of show you what Chris is asking. Okay, so let's just say that I want to go out and find this Utah Ed Chat hashtag and see what people are talking about. So I went to Twitter. I've already signed in. Now I'm under the Jordan DTL account here, but let's say I want to go see what was going on in Utah Ed Chat last week. So I'm going to come up to the search box in the top right corner, and I'm going to use the # UTED chat, and I'm going to hit enter on that. Now you can see that it pulls up. Kira looks like she was pretty active in it last week, so it's got her comment that she kind of shared last week. If I want to see, it says top here, it means that these got some responses or they got some favorites here. But if I want to see like what people have been talking about for the last few minutes, I can click on latest and it will show me the most recent one. So Camille was in here 6 hours ago and she shared this comment here. If I wanted to retweet this or share this with my audience, down at the bottom, I've got these four different little symbols that kind of help me do some different things with this. So let's say I wanted to share this to my learners. I'd click the retweet and it gives me an option to either just send her message out as is, or I can add my comment to it. So that's something that Chris, maybe you're talking about a little bit, is do I share her tweet and add my 2 cents to it, or do I just share her tweet? You can choose whichever you want. Sometimes I have commentary I want to make on it, so I do the quote tweet so that I can share what I want to say about it. If I want to ask her a question though, or talk with her about it, you see the little speech bubble here. That lets me send her a message. So you can see now when I send my reply, she'll be notified that I'm talking to her. And this will help her to kind of know that I'm asking her a question or learning a little bit about what she said. The heart just means that I'm saying, I like this one. And she'll get notified as well that somebody said, hey, I like your comment. That's great. The last one gives you an option to share or just download this. So if you want to use it in a presentation or share it with a different platform, you can click that button and you can share it in different ways. But when we're doing Utah Ed Chat, this is how it works really, is that people will come in, they'll search that hashtag, and then all of a sudden you'll start to see over the course of the hour that we're in there, you'll see people asking questions and sharing ideas with each other. And then if you go to the USET page, and it's uset.org/UtahEdChat. You can see the schedule that's coming up. So like this week, we're talking about computer science standards for elementary, younger grades. Next week, I'm talking about how do you break patterns in education because it's Groundhog's Day. So we'll see if we can break the bad habits, right? Or how do we keep teachers in education, retaining educators? That's going to be the topic the week after. So it's all different kinds of topics, but I mentioned how many years we've been doing this. If you were to click on any one of these, let's say, let's look at last year, you can see an archive of all the chats that we did. So even if you weren't able to participate live with us, you could come in here and say, oh, they did an episode on podcasts. I'd love to know more about podcasts and how people are using them. As I click on this, it will open up a little link that shows me the chat. So literally it goes through every week, you know, all the comments in the chat. So I could go back even now a year later and see what people were talking about last year on podcasts. So we tried to make this a place where you can learn about it live by participating, but you can also learn about it as an archive later when if you miss something. And this has been, for me, it's been a great way for us to connect with educators and to learn from each other with people all over the state. So I'm going to pause and to see if anyone else has any questions, because I want to make sure I answer your specific questions. But hopefully we've given you at least a little bit of an overview of how this whole thing works.
That was good.
I'm going to stop sharing then. But yeah, like I say, you know, it's funny. Back in 2010, I remember having a discussion with a colleague of mine where I said, you know, I don't know if you can have relationships with people that you start online in the real world. You know, because it seemed like to me back then where your relationship began is where it kind of lived. If you knew people in your real world, you didn't really necessarily just connect with them in social media. You kept connecting with them in the real world. You might follow them on Facebook and look at their pictures, but you'd still call them and do things like that. But I didn't think the opposite was true. Like somebody that I met online, I didn't know that I could really become friends with them. But I think what Kira and Chris have both kind of shared with us has been my experience. Like I've actually run into people that I've known mostly through Twitter. And when I see them, it's like we're friends. Like we have conversations and thoughts, and we've already built all that groundwork of things because we've been sharing with each other for months. You know, we've really connected with each other. So I think that's one of the best parts of Utah EdChat is it just gives you a broader group of teachers that you can work with and connect with. So there's my two cents. I'm going to turn it back to Clint.
Well, real quick, I agree so much with that. And I remember doing NetSafe trainings and having to tell kids, don't make friends with people you don't know in real life online. You know, and I'm thinking, no. I've, you know, some of the best people that I've met in real life, I met online. So yeah, you can open yourself up to so many other thoughts and different viewpoints by engaging with people online and get so many great ideas. So.
But I will say
my wife online, so I'd be in trouble if I followed.
Well, and I would say, Chris, like when you're talking about cyber, you know, safety.
Yeah, that's
one of the reasons why we say like, oh, I search for people that I kind of know first and then I follow people that they know.
Yeah.
And so in a way, I'm kind of doing exactly what you're teaching there is like, I'm not just following random people. I'm usually filtering by a few things that make it a little safer.
Yeah. But it's not all bad.
No, it's not bad.
Clint wouldn't have Kelly if he didn't go online every once in a while.
That's right. Yeah, that's of course, right. I didn't meet her on Twitter. I did another service for that. All right. Any other questions for Mr. Covili on Utah EdChat or Twitter in general?
Well, we'd love to have you join us anytime you can make it.
Thanks, sir. That was great. I appreciate that. So quickly, let's go through my little weekly PSAs. Here's our schedule for next month. Next week, we're going to talk about Adobe Spark has kind of pivoted and rebranded Spark. And now it's called Creative Cloud Express. And they've added a lot of cool new features and capabilities in there. So we're going to talk about that next week. Week after that, Chris is going to be covering the new eMedia LTI that allows you to link to e-media videos and not worry about logins and all that kind of stuff right in Canvas. Week after that, Matthew Winters from UN is going to talk about Canva in depth. He is a power user for sure, and that's a great tool for quick graphics and good looking, you know, like, you know, infographics and things like that. He'll do a great job with that. And then we'll talk about the options you have for customized posters from us at near the end of the month. And speaking of Utah EdChat, here's tomorrow's topic, like we covered before, talking about K-5 computer science standards with Miles Peterson. He's a very bright individual. Glad to have him leading that off next week. As always, check out the UAN Homebrew podcast. I listened to a little bit older, maybe a couple weeks ago, a session coming back from a training last week on, it was, they talked to the authors of the Developing Digital Detectives book, that there is now a UEN course that Chris is leading. Is that's starting up in March, right?
Right. I'm looking forward to that one.
Yeah, that'll be a good one. Really, but it was good. It was a wonderful discussion, and just great ideas about media literacy, and you know, just things to think about as even as adults, you know, let alone kids.
That podcast has gotten so much better in the last year.
Say that again.
I said that podcast has gotten so much better in the last 6 months.
It really has. The guy who was doing it before, he kind of lost his spark and his passion. It was time for him to move on to another position. Of course, we're kidding. Sign the roll. I've sent that out a couple times. We'll post the archive for you on our YouTube playlist. And that's it. We hope to see you next week. I'm going to stop my share.